Well, good morning. It's a nice rainy morning here. At Heaven's back porch. I'd like to spend a few minutes with you today because I was approached last week with a little challenge to help some people out in another country with a little problem that they have. So I accepted the challenge and did a little research and came up with a little study about a subject that will probably step on a lot of toes, and as we say here in the hills, I'll probably be getting in some muddy water. But anyway, the subject is idolatry and what the Bible will teach us about it. There are countries around the world, all different kinds of people, all different kinds of religions, just everything. But when I look at the word idolatry, there seems to be a little bit of confusion. And like I said, I'll probably step on some toes here, but I can't help it. This is what I've discovered with the help of a special friend of mine that gave me an idea and a direction to pursue. With that said, I want to begin with the very first commandment of the Ten Commandments. God wrote on the stones that he gave to Moses as he was up on the mount to be delivered down to the people of the land. Now in my Bible, the King James, it's right in the back of the book, and it tells you where to look for a quick reference. You'll find them in Exodus chapter 20, verse 3 through 17. The very first commandment, thou shalt have no other gods before me. I want you to notice how that's written. They use the lowercase g in the word God. This means all other things are not to be worshipped. This reminds me of an origin about idols. When Moses was on the mount, the people below had created a golden calf to be worshipped. And when Moses came down from the mount, he saw that golden calf. And he must have thought to himself, holy cow. This might be the origin of that saying. Back to the subject. Let's look at the difference between worship and honor. Worship, in the Old Testament Hebrew language, number 7812, in your Strong's Concordance, is pronounced Shaka. Prostrate, to give homage to royalty or God. Bow self down, crouch, fall down, humbly beseech, make to stoop, worship. Fifty-four times it's used with that definition. Once as number 6087 in Jeremiah 44 verse 19. 8 times is 5457. And there's one time of no definition in 1 Kings chapter 12 verse 30. That's a total of 64 times this word is used in the Old Testament with 3 definitions. In the Greek or New Testament, that would be number 4352. Proskoleo, to kiss like a dog licking its master's hand, to fawn or crouch, to prostrate oneself in homage, do reverence to, adore, worship. 34 times with that definition. 3 times as number 4576. 1 time is number 1391, 3 times is number 3000, 1 time is 2151, and 1 time is 1479, and another time is 1799. Total of 45 times in the New Testament, seven different definitions of that word. That word worship is used 109 times throughout the whole Bible. Now let's look at the word honor. The fifth commandment, honor thy father and mother, that the days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. In the Hebrew Old Testament, number 3513, kabed, make honorable, for the short definition, 90 times in the Old Testament with various definitions. In the Greek or New Testament, number 5092, time, a value, honor, precious, 53 times in the New Testament with various definitions. And I say that because there's quite a few definitions of these words. 143 total times in the Bible, the word honor. And I will add to that respect. The point is the difference between honor and worship is where we get mixed up and end up sinning against God. We can honor many things and many people with respect. People that save lives, the flag, the snakes, the bears, the land, the eagles, etc. As some cultures do, but those cultures also know the difference between worship of God or the Great Spirit and the respect of nature. The point is, God is spirit, and we worship Him in the spirit only, not with objects. We walk by faith, not by sight. Blessed are those that believe and yet have not seen. God speaks to our heart through His grace. The definition of grace is the divine inspiration upon the heart and the evidence of it in the life. In other words, we are divinely inspired and we act on that inspiration with what we do with it in our life. Faith without works is dead. If we saw a person that was hungry and our heart tells us to help that person find some food, that is an act of grace. Divine inspiration with action. What we do about it in our life. I hope this helps those people that have not the understanding of their actions and thus have separated themselves from our Heavenly Father and His love and the love of His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, of whom nobody can know the Father but through the Son. I know this probably offended a few people, but this is what I've learned and what I would like to share to help the country that asked me to give them some guidance and teaching tribes of unknowing knowledge. These are ministers and pastors that go out into villages and they preach the gospel to people that worship things not knowing any better. I hope this helps those people. In Jesus' name, God bless you all. Amen.